Hello and welcome to St Alfred's Online and St Luke's Online. My name is Mark Simon and I'm one of the ministry team that serve both our churches. Thank you for joining us for this service, which includes song, prayer and teaching from God's Word. We're continuing our series on the Book of Acts, and in just a little while Mike McNamara will preach on Acts 3, healing in Jesus' name. Let's begin now with an opening prayer, praising God for his salvation. Blessed are you, God of compassion and mercy. To you be praise and glory forever. In the darkness of our sin, your light breaks forth like the dawn, and your healing springs up for deliverance. As we rejoice in the gift of your saving help, sustain us with your bountiful spirit. And open our lips to sing your praise. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God forever. We're going to sing now, and following the song, we'll hear a kids' talk from Ross and Naomi, and then the Bible reading and the sermon from Mike.
Rejoice in the name. Okay. $5.
Ha! $5.
Okay. $2.
Well. $2.
Okay. $1.35.
Oof. $1.35.
$50. I win.
Not so fast. $100. What's more, $500. And I have two houses and a hotel. What's more, I even own the entire board. So I'm going to put my houses over here on Northumberland Avenue. I'm going to put this one over here on Vine Street. And I think I win everything. Checkmate!
No. So today's story is about a man who was richer than anyone else and he didn't have a cent. Now, this might seem impossible, but in Acts chapter 3, we read the story of two disciples, John and Peter, that go into the temple. And as they go in, they come across a beggar, someone who had been lame their whole life. And without even looking up to Peter and John, he was asking for money, probably so he could eat. But Peter said, look up at me. Silver and gold I don't have, but what I have I give to you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Walk.
Well, pretty soon this man was walking and leaping all over the place. Not only that, he was also praising God because it wasn't through money that he was able to be healed, but through the power of Jesus himself. Now, the question is though, which is worth more? Having sort of wallets full of cash or being healed?
Well, of course it's being healed, because getting to see the power of God and being able to praise him is amazing. Now, our bodies are only temporary, but being able to praise God is eternal and it lasts forever.
Well, of course, we live in a world that really values money, and sometimes it feels like a competition. The person with the most money wins. Well, this story, though, is a reminder that there's something so much more and so much bigger going on as well. And money is helpful, and it's good to be able to get food and other things that are really important and that help us. But knowing God and seeing his power and being able to be friends with Jesus completely trumps everything else, even money. Mm-hmm.
Hey, I thought I was the sheriff.
This week's Bible reading is from the book of Acts, chapter 3, verses 1 through 16. One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer, at 3 in the afternoon. Now a man who was lame from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts. When he saw Peter and John about to enter, he asked them for money. Peter looked straight at him, as did John. Then Peter said, "Look at us." So the man gave them his attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, "Silver or gold I do not have, but what I do have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." Taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God. When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at what happened to him. While the man held on to Peter and John, all the people were astonished and came running to them in the palace called Solomon's Colonnade. When Peter saw this, he said to them, "Fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? Why do you stare at us, as if by our own power or godliness we have made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant Jesus. You handed him over to be killed, and you disowned him before Pilate, though he has decided to let him go. You disowned the Holy and Righteous One, and asked that a murderer be released to you. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses of this. By faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. It is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him that has completely healed him, as you can all see. This is the word of the Lord.
Have you ever had an heirloom in your family? Perhaps a piece of jewellery, a painting, a very old book, a beautiful mahogany table. And your family thinks that perhaps the jewellery's by Fabergé, the painting's by Monet, the book is an early Shakespeare folio, and the table could be Chippendale. The only problem is you need provenance. That is, you need a credible trail of documents and proofs leading you as far back as possible to the piece that's in your possession, the book, the painting, and which is linking it very clearly to Monet, Fabergé, or whoever. If you've ever seen the TV show Fake or Fortune, where people ask for works of art in their possession to be properly verified, provenance is a massively important part of it. These items need authenticating. Are they genuine or fake? As we've been learning in this series in the book of Acts, the Christian church was just coming to life. It had just been born on the day of Pentecost. But could the message about Jesus really be believed? Last week, we heard how 3,000 believed it and turned to Christ. But there were thousands more in Israel at that time, and of course, millions worldwide, who still needed to know that this was a message and a saviour worthy of our full trust and allegiance. Which brings us to a day at the Jerusalem temple and the healing. Luke, the author of Acts, starts relaying the sequence of events. He writes, "One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the time of prayer, at 3 p.m. Now a man who was lame from birth was being carried to the temple gate called Beautiful, where he was put every day to beg from those going into the temple courts." We can imagine that the beggar, who had been lame from birth, had done the same thing every day for many, many years. As he woke up that morning, there was no reason for him to think that this day would be any different from any other. We know from later on in Acts that he was over 40 years old, a considerable age in the ancient world. So his routine in life would have been set, his future prospects bleak. There was no chance of employment, there were no disability benefits, and so the only option was the demeaning one of begging. The only thing in his favour was a group of friends or family who each day kindly placed him next to the 75-foot-tall brass-covered temple gate, the Beautiful Gate, so he could at least get some money to survive. It must have been a soul-destroying existence, which is perhaps why he never looked up at Peter and John when he asked them for money that day. The apostles had come to pray at the temple, 3 p.m. being one of the three set times for daily prayer there. When the beggar asked for money, he was probably used to either getting the odd coin put in his begging bowl or being totally ignored. But today was different. He was spoken to by Peter, who looked straight at him and said, "Look at us." Well, that certainly got the man's attention. He looked up straight away, expecting to get something from them, we're told in verse 5. Perhaps Peter and John wanted to show him a large sum of money that they were about to place in his bowl. But no doubt to the man's great disappointment at the time, Peter declared, "Silver or gold I do not have." We can imagine the beggar's thoughts. They tell me to look at them and get all my hopes up, and then they don't have any money to give me. But Peter's not finished yet, not by a long way. "Silver or gold I do not have, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." Peter and John had followed Jesus for over 3 years. They had seen so many healing miracles, including blind Bartimaeus being given his sight, the paralyzed man lowered through the roof, but who then picked up his mat and walked home totally healed by the word of Jesus. And then, of course, Jairus' daughter, raised from the dead. They'd been there. They'd seen it all. And now that Jesus was risen and ascended, and they had been filled with the Holy Spirit and given special power and authority as apostles, as those who were personally chosen and commissioned by Jesus, it was time to act and to demonstrate the power of the living Lord Jesus Christ. For the Apostle Peter, it had been a huge step to stand up and preach the sermon of Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost. But let's also recognize his faith and courage here to command the lame beggar at the temple gate to walk. That took real faith, real courage, to then reach out, take him by the hand, and help him up. Jesus, as the Son of God, had done such things, and Peter knew it now fell to him to reach out to those in need as Jesus had and demonstrate the power and the love that is in the name of his living Lord. And his faith was well placed. We read, "Instantly, the man's feet and ankles became strong. He jumped to his feet and began to walk. Then he went with them into the temple courts, walking and jumping and praising God." The exuberance and the joy of the healed man is so clear, isn't it? He hadn't really wanted money, had he? All his life, deep down, he had wanted healing. And that was the very thing that Peter could give him. What a day to remember. No wonder he was jumping. He was praising God too. He instinctively knew that this was God's work, not Peter's. Now, many of them would have seen the beggar at the gate for years on end. Here's what Luke records about their reaction to the miracle. "When all the people saw him walking and praising God, they recognized him as the same man who used to sit begging at the temple gate called Beautiful. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him." Of course, the healing of the man was a fulfillment of Isaiah's messianic prophecy. "Then will the lame leap like a deer," in Isaiah 35. Would the people in the temple make the connection? Would they recognize that behind this remarkable miracle lay the hand of the very Messiah they had killed? Meanwhile, in all the ongoing commotion, we're told the healed man was clinging to Peter and John as onlookers looked at him in astonishment. Everyone wanted to see him. and still more of them were arriving on the scene, rushing from all corners of the temple as word of the healing miracle spread like wildfire. They gathered in Solomon's colonnade, a vast area which ran all the way along the eastern side of the temple's outer court. And then Peter, seeing his golden opportunity, seized it and preached his second Jerusalem sermon to the crowd that was incredibly eager to find out how such a miracle was possible, especially to a man that they knew. Half of them were probably still out of breath from running to the colonnade. And so to the message. When the Holy Spirit came in power at Pentecost, the Apostle Peter focused his message not so much on the Spirit, but on Jesus, calling on all people to turn to him. And now, once again, the focus isn't surprisingly on the healing itself, but on Jesus. In his message, Peter will explain why. And he begins with two questions. Fellow Israelites, why does this surprise you? And second, why do you stare at us as if by our own power or godliness we have made this man walk? Now, a lot of tricksters and charlatans and people on the make would have been quick to take the credit and take more than a few bucks for such an incredible miracle. But not Simon Peter. He was the faithful servant of his master. He knew the miracle was all Jesus' work and that it was in his name and for his glory. Peter had told the lame man, "In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk." The credit and the glory all belonged to Jesus. And now it was time to tell the people just that, and to remind them of how they had treated Jesus, who was and is so much more than they had ever realized. And perhaps you watching today, more than you have ever realized. These people who'd grown up in the Jewish faith all adored and revered the great founding fathers of the people of Israel, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. These were their heroes, and rightly so. But Peter now informs them, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his servant, Jesus. Embarrassingly for them, they were to discover that the God of their great and revered founding fathers was also the God of Jesus. More than that, Jesus was God's servant, the suffering servant prophesied in Isaiah. As we'll discover when we get to chapter 8 of the book of Acts, there's a fascinating scene where a high-ranking African official from Ethiopia is reading all about this suffering servant from Isaiah chapter 53. And he reads these words. He was led like a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before the shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. In his humiliation, he was deprived of justice. At that time, the Ethiopian dignitary asks a Christian leader of the early church, Philip the Evangelist, who was with him that day, he asks him whom this prophecy in Isaiah is referring to. And Philip is able to tell him it's a prophecy about Jesus, who suffered so that we might be forgiven. As Isaiah also wrote, he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And the Lord has laid on him the sin of us all. I wonder if the crowd in the temple colonnade were beginning to put the pieces together. If Jesus was indeed God's suffering servant, and the miracle of healing was done in his name and to glorify him, just as Peter says it was, God has glorified his servant Jesus, then what on earth had they done? Who had they nailed to a cross in that very city just a few weeks earlier? Well, Peter now tells them. He told them in his first sermon in Acts chapter 2, but this was a new audience, and they needed to hear the truth about Jesus and to face up what they had done to him. Peter, in a speech which pulls no punches, tells them that they had dishonored the Lord Jesus in four shameful ways. First, they'd handed him over to be killed. Peter tells them bluntly, "You handed him over to be killed." Not the religious authorities, not the mob, not the Romans, you. Many of them who were there that day in the temple to hear Peter would also have been those who had cried out, "Crucify him," on that first Good Friday. Second, they disowned Jesus before Pilate. Peter tells them, "You disowned him before Pilate, though he had decided to let him go." On that fateful day, there had stood the Son of God, and the people totally disowned him and rejected him as a common criminal, preferring that he should die rather than be released, which is what Pilate was planning to do. Pilate knew Jesus was innocent. So did they. Remember Pilate's question to the crowd. "What crime has this man committed? I have found in him no grounds for the death penalty." Then third, they disowned the righteous one. "You disowned the holy and righteous one and asked that a murderer be released to you," verse 14. How low could they go? They demanded the death of the innocent, the Holy One of God, and the release of the guilty, Barabbas, a notorious murderer. Hard to believe, isn't it? But of course, the sad truth is, all of us share in the guilt of this injustice. For as the Bible says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And fourth, they killed the author of life. Again, the charge against them is made very plainly. "You killed the author of life," verse 15. The very creator of all life was himself, in a coordinated, premeditated, and callous act, deprived of life. It's a horrific thought. The crowd in the temple that day would have heard these four irrefutable charges made against them, and if their consciences allowed them, would have recognized that the dreadful deed was done, and that they willingly had handed Jesus over and killed the author of life. There was no way back from that, surely. But Peter was there to tell them there was. That's the extraordinary message that Peter now delivers to them. "You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. We are witnesses of this." Verse 15. You see, how could the author of life stay dead? 3 days after Good Friday, God raised him to life again. And Peter and John were witnesses to the risen Jesus. and unashamedly and bravely say so. They'll face arrest and imprisonment shortly, but they will not deny the truth, the wonderful truth that Peter declared earlier in his first sermon in Acts 2. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. So if Jesus is the Christ, if he is the living, risen, ascended Lord, reigning in heaven, then it is surely no surprise that a man lame from birth is totally healed when Peter, with the authority of the risen Jesus, calls on Jesus' name in faith. And here at the end of our section, the Apostle Peter makes that very link to the healing. By faith in the name of Jesus, this man whom you see and know was made strong. It is Jesus' name and the faith that comes through him that has completely healed him, as you can all see. Verse 16. The healing has authenticated the truth of Peter's message. If the people were asking, how could that man be healed? They've now got their answer. The Jesus that they crucified and thought was still dead has risen from death and is alive to be known and worshipped by them and, of course, by us 2,000 years later. And so to the lessons. What could we take away from such a momentous event, from such a remarkable healing and a very compelling message by the Apostle Peter? Well, for a start, it demonstrated the truth of the gospel message to the hearers that day, and in our day too. This is history, not fairy stories. God was wanting to make known the truth about Jesus, the Savior of the world. He wanted the truth known then, and he wants it known today. In those very first months, how would people listen to the message of the apostles and take them seriously? Well, a miracle, such as the one we have been learning about, brought everyone rushing to Peter. It was a sign of God to authenticate the message of his servant and to demonstrate his authority as God's chosen apostle. And then, of course, Peter preached the gospel to them. And in next week's section, he will show them how to respond. If they felt guilty for the way he had treated Jesus, they would discover, as we can all discover, that there's a way back to God by admitting our wrongdoing and turning to God in faith and trust. Another aspect that this miracle raises is the question about healings and miracles today. As we've seen from this passage in Acts, it was a sign to authenticate the message that Peter was delivering. It's fair to say that in our own day, when extraordinary things happen in the name of Jesus, it's very often in a pioneer evangelism situation. I think of people I know, Dr. Martin and Elizabeth Goldsmith, who served in Indonesia back in the 60s and 70s as mission partners. They reached a very remote village that never heard the gospel, never heard of Jesus. They had a translator with them, and they encountered a man who had rotting teeth and was dying from the poisoning of his body system. This man needed healing. Martin had the gospel, but it was very clear this man said, look, this Jesus you're telling us about through the translator, can't you pray in his name? He's supposed to be all powerful. Martin, who's a scholar, prayed for that man. No one was more surprised when the man had a new set of teeth than Martin. He couldn't believe it. But that's God. And that village community realized that the message Martin had given them about Jesus was true. It was authentic. This miracle was a sign of it. In today's world, often that's how it's used. I think because God knows how fickle we are and that people can often just want signs and wonders and then they'll believe when they won't really listen to the message. But we believe here at St. Alfred's, it's important for people to receive prayer for healing. It's something that's there in James chapter 5, that if anyone is sick, they are to call the elders for prayer. It's something that we like to do here. And there are some wonderful stories of how God has helped people in that situation. And then finally, one of the takeaways here is really the centrality of Jesus, isn't it? Peter could have taken a lot of the glory for this miracle, but he refuses to do so. Jesus is the one who must have the glory. Which begs the question for us, who's at the center in our lives? Do we want the glory, or does Jesus get the glory? As we go into a new week, with this wonderful miracle story ringing in our ears and in our hearts, let's remember it's Jesus, the Savior, the living Lord who reigns in heaven, who is the one who must have the glory in our lives. Have a good week.
There is one.
Hebrews 4 tells us that Jesus is our great high priest. He is able to sympathize with us in our weaknesses and in our testing. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Our confession prayer today is shaped around the Kyrie prayer, Lord, have mercy. So please respond with the words in bold on your screen. You bore our weaknesses and carried our sorrows. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. You felt compassion for the people and went among them doing good. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. You commanded your apostles to heal the sick in your name. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy on us now and help us in our time of need. May the God of all healing and forgiveness draw us to himself and cleanse us from all our sins, that we may be whole and live to praise and honour him in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's now turn to God in prayer for the world, the church, and each other.
Gracious Father, we come before you now to pray for your healing power to touch our world, our nation, our city, our loved ones, and our churches. The name of Jesus of Nazareth is powerful to change lives, bringing healing and hope. And we pray for the peoples of the world, especially where hope is faint. Heal the economies of nations caught in poverty and debt. Heal the political systems of nations where the lives and rights of citizens are devalued or demeaned. Heal the health systems of nations ravaged by pandemic. Heal the justice systems of nations where injustice is prevalent and the vulnerable lack protections. Give wisdom to those in authority in every land, and give to all people a desire for righteousness and peace, with the will to work together in trust, to seek the common good, and to share with justice the resources of the earth. In our own nation, we are conscious of recent disclosures of abuse in Parliament, in workplaces, in school settings. We know, Lord, that you hear the cry of all who have suffered such abuse. Help us to hear and respond with your compassion and commitment to justice. We pray for reform and healing of toxic workplaces and institutions where power is misused. Turn the hearts of abusers away from evil. Fill them with hatred for the damage they cause, and bring them to true repentance and change of life. We pray for healing and reform of our society, where there is not gender equality in pay or leadership or opportunity. We pray for healing of attitudes that excuse or enable sexual harassment in workplaces. We pray for healing in the area of racism. Help us to all recognize bias in our own attitudes and work for a common life of unity, mutual respect, and equal treatment. We pray for the health of your church. Guide and govern it by your good spirit, so that all who call themselves Christians may be led in the way of truth and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in righteousness of life. We pray especially for our ministers at St. Alfred's and St. Luke's, Peter, Mike, Mark, and the broader staff team. We pray for our Archbishop Philip and regional bishops Genevieve and Paul. We ask that we might, like the early apostles, boldly declare the good news of Jesus to a needy world and show compassion to all who are in need. We pray for our mission partners, those active in tertiary education, in international education, in mission aviation, in mission to seafarers. Strengthen and encourage them to live in the power of your Spirit and step out in the name of Jesus. We pray for those in need of healing from sickness, in body, mind, or spirit. In the mighty name of Jesus, we ask that you restore to health all who are suffering. Strengthen their body, comfort their heart, calm their mind. Give them a firm trust in your goodness. And we bring all our prayers to you in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
crucified, you set me free. Now I live to bring him praise.
I'd like to share a few notices with you now. Firstly, we're still refining our plans for Easter services. You can expect an update and an outline of the service times next week. Secondly, if you're free on Saturday morning, the 20th of March, we're holding a working bee at St. Luke's at Vermont. The car park is now finished and we're going to be re-establishing gardens and tidying up the site. Next Sunday, the 21st of March, there'll be an information and welcome gathering for new people connected to the St. Alfred's 10 a.m. service. It'll run from 11:30 a.m. to midday at St. Alfred's. You can contact the office to register. Our youth group, Pulse, is holding a youth camp in the school holidays. Registrations close on the 22nd of March, so please check the website for details and to register. Finally, St. Alfred's is supporting this year's Winter Shelter Program. This is a program coordinated by the Combined Churches of Whitehorse, and it provides overnight accommodation for the homeless in Whitehorse. If you're interested in helping out, information sessions will be running next week. See the link below for details. Let's conclude our time now with this closing prayer. Father of all mercies, for your gifts of healing and forgiveness, for grace to love and care for one another, for your hidden blessings, and for all you have in store for us, we give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. Thanks so much for joining us for our online service this week. God bless you and look forward to seeing you again.